you can be found in the book of Matthew, 26th chapter, starting at the 20th verse. Matthew 26th chapter, starting at the 20th verse, and I'll be reading to the 30th verse. You able, please stand. It is on the screen if you can't find it just yet. The reading from the NIV version. When evening came, Jesus was reclining at the table with the 12. And while they were eating, he said, "Truly I tell you, one of you will betray me." And they were very sad and began to say to him one after the other, "Surely you don't mean me, Lord." Jesus replied, "The one who dips his hand in the bowl with me will betray me. The Son of Man will go just as it is written about him. But woe to the man who has betrayed him, the Son of Man. It will be better for him that he had not been born." Then Judas, the one who would betray him, said, "Surely you don't mean me, Rabbi." Jesus answered, "You have said so." While they were eating, Jesus took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body." Then he took the cup, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, "Drink from it, all of you. This is my blood of the covenant, which is poured out for many for the forgiveness of sin. I tell you, I will not drink from the fruit of the vine from now on until that day when I drink it new with my Father's kingdom." And when they had sung songs and hymns, they went to the Mount of Olives. May God have blessed us with the God's word. The word of God for people of God. Amen. Let's pray. Well, first and most of God, Lord, we just thank you, Lord, for just another Sunday, Lord. Allowing us to see another first Sunday, Lord. Lord, allowing us to make it through 6 months of this calendar year. Lord, we thank you for another opportunity to just partake in communion. Well, now we just ask that you steady our minds, steady our spirits, so we might hear a word from you. Lord, we heard you in song. We heard you in prayer. We experienced you in fellowship. We worship you in giving. Lord, now let us hear a word from you. Lord, help us to take this word and not get all on unfertile ground, but it to mature and become what you need it to be, so that we can feed all those around us. Oh, we thank you, and we love you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. So, right now we are full in summer. Some of the dog days of summer are upon us. It's getting hotter and hotter. Summer is here, and this is the time for our blockbuster movie season. Yes, yes, blockbuster movie season. Yes, companies are releasing some of their biggest hits right now in this period because they are expecting us to want to beat the heat and go into the theater. They are doing this from May until September. That they are hoping that we will spend our hard-earned money on fantasy, on all of the things that they place before us. The word blockbuster means something that is very large, very expensive, or successful. Massive amounts of money are spent on movies by production houses, and they're banking that they'll make their money back, that they'll have a return at the box office. But how many of us are truly seeking a blockbuster life? How many of us are seeking a blockbuster life? Are we spending our time just living, just trying to get by? Are we trying to have the best life that we possibly can? Are we trying to be what God has truly called us to be? Are we seeking to have a blockbuster life, a life that is worth living? So when we cross to the other side, God will say, "My good and faithful servant, with you I am well pleased." And are we seeking a blockbuster life? Well, I started a sermon series on Father's Day called A Blockbuster Life. We think massive amounts of money will make everything right. We think if we have just the right people in our lives, someone that can hold a starring role. You know that prince in shining armor that you've been waiting for. That dark, the long piece of chocolate that you know that dark, tall, and handsome. Yeah, that woman with the curves that you know just make you say, "Help me, help me." Come back. But we all are looking for someone to help us have a blockbuster life. Some of us, we've been playing Mega Millions, and you know, we're waiting on that $270 million. If I could just win that, my life would be blockbuster. Oh, yeah, some of us, we say, "I don't need the $270 million. All I need is a million." If I could get that house I wanted, that job, that promotion I wanted, my life would be blockbuster. When we think that things can make our lives blockbuster. But we think if we allow so-and-so to direct our lives, our life would be great and grand. We would have a blockbuster life. I think we have been misled, though, by the hype. So, for the next few Sundays, I'm going to continue this sermon series of Blockbuster Life. And I'm going to take some of the elements of what makes a blockbuster life and couple it with popular movie titles. So that we can have a formula for creating a blockbuster life. And as I thought about this a couple of Sundays ago, I spoke on Father's Day, I asked the question, who's directing your life? If you want a blockbuster film, you want a good director. If you want truly, any production company knows that a good director can make or break a movie. And so on that Sunday, on Father's Day, I talked about how God needs to direct this thing called our life. If we would just allow God to direct our lives, then our world would be very different. But too many of us, we want everything else and everybody else to direct our lives. We want our friends and our cohorts to direct our lives. But if we would just let God direct our lives, our lives would be totally different, because God knows the script that God has written for you. When we allow God to direct us, then the end result is always a blockbuster. See, the problem is that we allow subpar individuals to direct and influence our life. When we allow subpar people who have the potential to be great, but don't understand that they have some greatness in them, we allow them to direct our lives. We allow them to have influence on what we do. As I reflected on what makes a blockbuster movie, I realized another important element are the individuals that hold supporting roles in our life. You know, every movie has a star. Every movie has a star, and you are the star of your life. You are the star, but the people around you hold supporting roles. And don't you know, if you ain't got the right people around you, your life will be messed up. So somebody said, "Show me your closest five friends, and I'll show you how you're going to look in 10 years. And the people that are around you will impact you more than outside forces. If you are hanging around folk that don't want to go anywhere, guess what? You ain't going nowhere. If your homeboy just want to sit around and smoke, you ain't going nowhere. If your homegirl just want to sit up and gossip, you ain't going to get nothing to help me hold your life." So the problem is, we allow supporting actors in our life that don't mean any good for us. So I want to talk about that. I want to talk about all how people in our lives can affect us, or how people in our lives can cause us to do certain things or how we can affect them. How we respond to the cues of those supporting actors will dictate the life that we live. So since this is the first Sunday of July, and right before the 4th of July, and y'all know how I feel about the 4th of July, I realize that this is a period in which we celebrate the birth of this nation. And in this period, we are reminded of how great it is to be in America, how America is the home of the brave and the land of the free. On this Sunday before the 4th of July, we're celebrating the independence of white America. Help me. While the ink was drying, and they were saying that we were three-fifths. Wait, it's in the Constitution, no? Go read it. They were saying we were three-fifths. God help me, Holy Ghost. And it said that you are endowed with certain inalienable rights, but we had to, help me, Holy Ghost. I know, I'm messing up somebody's barbecue. I'm gonna make it real. It tastes kind of funny, but. He said, what to the Negro is the 4th of July? When he was called to do a speech, he understood that we had no rights in this country. And though we fought in every war, though we've been present and we helped build this nation, we still can be shot down in the streets. We still can be mistreated. People will still take other folks' word over ours. We are still mistreated. They're the very founders of this nation. They separated children from their parents. Help me, Holy Ghost. No, you shouldn't be surprised that they're separating kids from their parents. Yes, Thomas Jefferson, George Washington, yes, they sold slaves. When George Washington found himself in a financial strait, he sold off slaves. Yes, he did. And so don't get it twisted. This is separating kids from their parents in American as apple pie. The founders of this nation have destroyed families. Why are family reunions so important to the black community? Because our families were separated. And after the Emancipation Proclamation, after we were freed from slavery, there were folk that went out looking for their family. They put ads in newspapers trying to find their family. They spoke to people. And so we understand this whole notion of being separated from family. They took advantage of black bodies. They took away, you know Sally Hemings, they say, oh, they had a love affair, but I thought Sally didn't have a choice with Thomas Jefferson. They publicly execute a people of color. Now, a 17-year-old black boy, he gets out the car and runs. I know somebody said, why does he stay in the car? Why should he stay in the car when you can sit in your car and still be shot? So he had a better chance of running. Help me, Holy Ghost. Four times. Yet, a man who walks into a newspaper, kills five people. Taken alive. A boy who walks into a high school. Kills 12 people. We are guilty until proven innocent. My others are innocent until proven guilty. Oh yes, 4th of July is an interesting holiday. On this Sunday before the 4th, we recognize the birth of this nation, but we realize it's toxic rhetoric.
Right.
It's toxic rhetoric. How it was raised on rugged individualism, how it fed on the breast of greed, how it learned to walk holding the hands of systematic oppression, how its words dealt with its first words were dehumanized, and how it attended the school of xenophobia.
All right.
And because of its rhetoric, America has always sought to stop those who wanted a seat at the table of justice. Have always sought to stop those from getting what God has deemed to them. And in my prayers and meditation, the movie Coming to America rested on my spirit. Y'all know Coming to America. Y'all know Eddie Murphy and James Earl Jones and Arsenio Hall and Chris Akeem. Y'all know about Chris Akeem. He was following tradition, or his family wanted him to follow tradition, and so they brought him his bride on his 21st birthday, but he said he wanted to find love, so he wanted to break tradition. Arsenio Semi tells him that is tradition that you're supposed to receive your bride, but I like what he says in that. He says, tradition is that time must always change. So tradition is the fact that time is all change is inevitable. Change is always going to occur. The interesting thing about this movie, it is 30 years old this weekend. 30 years old. It has been 30 years. Somebody, I'm dating somebody because they can watch the movie. 30 years ago. 30 years ago, Coming to America came out. Yes. This movie was relatable to so many because it showed Africa in a different light. And you remember the movie? You remember when they came out dancing? And they came out looking all like and the big palace and everything he wanted, he had. It showed the wealth of Zamunda. Well, before Wakanda, there was Zamunda. But then this title is appropriate and it's not appropriate for the 4th of July weekend. Because it's appropriate because this whole notion of coming to America and what coming to America is, but it's not appropriate because this is the first Sunday. So I had to strike out. I had to do a little editing. Can I do a little editing on the title of Coming to America? Can I edit the title? So instead of it being Coming to America, I'm gonna strike through the America and put Coming to Communion. Help. We have to see the thing about coming to America. Coming to communion. We have to examine how we come to communion. Personally, we must ask who's showing up at communion. This Sunday, who's showing up? Now, I'm not talking about your name. I'm not talking about so and so coming to church. I'm talking about who's showing up at communion. Who got out the car with you? And I'm not talking about your kids or your brother. Who's showing up? So let's explore this thing and tag this text, Coming to Communion. Coming to Communion. Right now, America only wants certain people, but God has an open door policy. God invites us all to come sit at the table. So even though the Supreme Court said that certain people can't come into this nation, God always opens the doors to all of God's children. In the text, Jesus is making a similar statement to his disciples. He's making a similar statement to his disciples. If I remix this, it simply would read that Jesus sits back at the table and he says, who's coming to communion? Who's coming to communion? Who's coming to communion? Passover, this thing called the Passover meal. It's in Matthew, it's in Mark, it's in Luke, and it's even in John. And so this communion meal is in, but it depends on what text you read. See, in Matthew, Mark, and Luke, the meal is on Passover. But if you read John, the meal is the day before Passover. Amen. It just depends on the account that is occurring. And if you want to learn more about that, you need to come. The Bible says, we talk about the people who come to the Bible study, they know that. But here it is, Passover, an important thing in the Jewish faith. Passover, the Passover meal, and the entire week was important because it reminded the people that God is a God of liberation. God is a God of the oppressed. God can move you out of any situation. Regardless of where you find yourself in life, God can move you out of that situation. And the thing is, it tells us that all of us are invited to the table. All of us, the thing I love about this text is everybody is invited to the table. And Jesus doesn't say, you got to get up and go because you don't know how to act. Jesus invites everybody to the table. And the thing is, though, we all have a seat at the table. The problem is, who will show up at the table? And how will we show up for dinner? How will we show up at the table? How will we show up at dinner? Well, okay, I'm going to tell you. See, the thing is, who shows up? See, we all fall into one of these four categories at some point in our life. Some point in our life, we are. At some point, we all are betrayers. We all have a Judas factor. Help me. So we all, at some point, have betrayed Jesus. We all turned our back on Jesus. We betrayed Jesus. We all have that propensity to betray Jesus. But here it is. Jesus allows the one who would betray him to still sit at the table. All of us have betrayed Jesus at some point in our lives. We all have a little Judas in us. The next thing is, we all have a little denier in us. We all have a little bit of denier in us. What do you mean, Reverend? We've all denied Christ at some point. You know that simple dinner when you out with your colleagues and nobody's praying, and you pray every night at your dinner table, but you don't pray because you don't want to make anybody uncomfortable, or you don't talk about Jesus because you don't want to make anybody. I'm not talking to anybody. Okay, we all have been deniers at some point in our life. But then, the other one, we all at some point have been a doubter. We doubted what God had for our life. We doubt what it says. So we have that Thomas effect. You got to show me. I got to be able to touch it, taste it, and feel it. God says, you know what? Go out and start that business. And you're like, well, God, you know, time just ain't right. And God says, no, step out. You got it. Be like, no, God, I just need some more signs. Okay. We all got a little powder in us. We all got, so somebody's saying, you know what? I ain't never betrayed Jesus. I ain't never denied Jesus. I never doubted God's word. Well, you know what? And you probably have been fell in the line with the other nine disciples. You probably are an abandonment. You abandoned me. When things get hard, when stuff don't turn out your way, when you've been praying for something and praying for it to work out, when you prayed that daddy would get well or mama would get well and it didn't work out, and you said, well, you know what, God? All I asked you for, all I've done for you, and you won't even give me this? Forget you, God. We come to communion, we thinking about all the other stuff. We and how Junior was just playing crazy, and you don't know how he's your child.
That's Michelangelo's cousin. Help me. That is not Jesus. out, huh?
But we've been ostracized so much that we don't feel like we're worth it. I'm almost out your way. But I need to give you this, and then I'm gonna take my seat. Well, what do we do when we get to the table? What do we find at the table? What do we find at the table? The first thing we find at the table, we find grace. What is grace? And when you get out of that 28th verse, it says we die for our sins. What? We find grace at the table. Grace is favor or kindness shown without regard for worth, merit. It's something you didn't deserve.
Amen.
You didn't do anything. So the whole symbolism of communion is grace. Jesus said, my body and my blood is poured out for you.
So
when you come to the table, the meal is grace. He's saying that God thought so much of you. Thought that you were so important that he would get on the cross for you. I don't care what you're going through. I don't care what struggles you might have. But you're still here. And that means you've been afforded some grace that the world can't give you and that the world can't take away. And you have some grace. You have grace that nobody can move away from you. You have this thing that only God can give you. For it is by grace that you have been saved. Through faith and it is by grace that you have been saved. But it says, my grace is sufficient. My grace is sufficient. My power is made perfect in your weakness. It's grace. You find it at the table. But also you find guidance at the table. Jesus is instructing his disciples on what to do, on how to live. And when you come to the table, when you come to communion, you should be coming to communion and to church to find guidance on how to live your life. My mom didn't say it like this, but one of the things my mother said, she said, boy, she said, if I don't go to church, you going to church. She said, I work two jobs, and so I might be a little too tired to get up. So, but as long as you live in my house, as long as I see you coming here, let their kids tell them. Now, if you don't want to live here, you can go. And you ain't got to go to church. But as long as you live in my house, you're going to church. And so when I went to college, it was so ingrained in me. I had a roommate that didn't go to church. And so I tried to stay in bed one Sunday, but I just didn't feel right. It just something ain't right about the day. And so I started walking around campus. Wait, where did I go to church? And so it was so inside of me. That I knew I needed it. It guided because of the guidance that I got in here. Because of what God poured into me in this place. You find grace at the table. You find guidance at the table.
All right.
But then also, you find glory at the table. You find glory at the table. Now, I can stop right there. You find glory at the table. At this table, there's beauty and there's power. The most important thing is the beauty is that he went to the cross. The power is he got up. What people miss about that is what this is saying. He got up. I don't care how trying to bury you. Guess what? You can do it. Is he lives.
Yeah.
And because he lives, you can live. Because he lives, so he said, I came to give you life and life more. What? Abundantly. But then, what it is, what I end with is, what I realize, there's glory at the table. There's guidance at the table. But what else are you?
Somebody looked at the list and your name went on it.